Welcome to a new episode, where I am going to talk about how to lay asphalt. Here is a summary of what to expect in this video. Laying the base of the asphalt in concrete. Adjusting a manhole to the proper height. How to make a straight edge siding without using a concrete curb. Priming the base and the sidings of the house. Project management and work organization. How to properly lay the warm asphalt. And of course, how to make it walkable, drivable right after the pour. Plus, as a bonus, if you stay up to the end of the video, I am going to show you what mistakes to avoid doing while laying the asphalt, and how to clean the tools, and how to store them for a future use. But first, let me introduce myself. My name is Benjamin Sagow. Welcome to my channel, where we discuss many various topics, from how to renovate old buildings, how to build new projects, and even as far as how to care for your garden and many more things. In this particular video, we are going to focus on one single topic, and that is how to lay asphalt, and how it is different from pouring concrete. The process is quite similar, but in the same time so distinct. I am going to start by saying something many of you might find as very basic, but because the principle is so simple, it might very easy be overlooked. So I instruct you to take close attention to what I am about to say next. Both pouring concrete and asphalt laying are stressful procedures. If not done right, they need to be redone. That is why they both require very good planning and preferably the more trained people helping the better in order to get a fail-free project. But the similarities end here. In contrast, asphalt is good to work in a very hot climate, and much harder in a cold one. The opposite is for concrete, so it is a good thing to keep in mind when thinking of laying asphalt by yourself. Now, if done right, an asphalt pour can save you between 40 to 70% of the initial cost offered by a professional company, depending where in the world you might live and the taxes you are supposed to pay. But in the same time, a bad pour might cost you far much more, because it needs to be redone again. Now that we got that out of the way, let's start with the tools you need for the project. The first tool I am going to need for this specific project is a concrete breaker, but depending on your project specification, you might not need one. Then some hand tools, a shovel, wheelbarrow, hand stamper, an industrial gas burner with a gas tank, some winter mats to cover the trailer to keep the asphalt warmer, plate vibrator, a roller vibrator and an old painter's brush for the primer. Also something that gets overlooked again, proper roadwork signs and delimitations. And of course, a powerful car and a trailer. We start here by breaking the old asphalt and removing it to the recycling plant where we dispose of it to the right place according to our local guidelines. Then what I like to do after all the rubble is removed, is to start by vibrating the soil with the plate vibrator, until it gets hard when going on top of it. On the end where the edge line is, I dig a little deeper hole for better support just in case some big car would drive over, and it acts just like a submerged curb when the concrete is poured. The strength of the top asphalt layer is just as good as the underlay. So the better the soil is prepared, the longer the life cycle of the asphalt. In our case, the soil is sea sand. Very good since it is easy to compact, and it has very good drainage, that is an important aspect. If the underlay where you want to pour the asphalt is an impermeable substrate, for example, clay, you need to make sure it has good drainage for water, and that you use proper piping to ensure that is done right. Otherwise, if there is a big storm and the water sweeps under the asphalt, and a car or a truck drives over, the soil acts like a plastic foil, keeping the water just between the asphalt and itself. Even if you have gravel on top of the clay, if the water is not going away, at some point the gravel will get saturated with water, and start acting like a wobbly surface. The asphalt will most certainly crack or get damaged under the weight of the car compounded with the softness underneath. Before going to the next step, you need to make sure that the soil is good vibrated and does not move under your feet while you go on top of it. A good tip for a great compaction when compacting sand is to water it first and then vibrating it after. The surface needs to be completely clean and clear before continuing. There should be no grease or oil stains on top of it. In order to achieve proper drainage and prevent a collapsed or heaved surface, the top surface as well as the underlay should be graded in such way that water runs off to the sides from, away from the house. Preferably on a drainage of some sort. Now you can skip the concrete pouring if you are not willing to invest a lot of money in your project, but I would strongly advise you in not skipping it, since it will prolong the life of your asphalt with many more years. But if you do, make sure you treat the soil against weeds. You can basically go with a total kill pesticide, and avoid having weeds and plants growing trough the newly laid asphalt. The type of crushed rock used under the asphalt layer is crucial to proper drainage. The composition of the rock should be coarse and spiky. This type is usually called road base. If your underlying soil is clay-based, you will need 20 cm or 8 inches of crushed rock. If your underlying soil is sandy, you will need 10 cm or 4 inches of crushed rock. After that, stamp the crushed rock into the subsoil. Allow this base to settle for approximately 1 week. Every day I would suggest to water it, except 2 days before the asphalt laying. Many contractors will skip this step due to time. The benefit of allowing the base to settle is a stronger, more naturally settled base. If the base material is not allowed to settle properly, it will most likely fail from movement occurring under the new asphalt. In our case, we use concrete from the concrete station, whereas mixed as a curb concrete design, it is a drier than usual concrete with 8 mm or 1/8 inch size rock inside and it is designed to withstand the moisture in the ground. The mix is one part cement, one part rocks and two parts sand, and of course, very little water. The less water the more resistant the concrete is in the long term. When we pour the concrete we pour it on a thickness of 7 cm or 2 inches and 3 quarters and we vibrate it very thoroughly, 4 times with overlapping moves. The last layer of asphalt, the so-called asphalt sliding layer, will be in a thickness of around 3 to 4 cm or 1 inch, the 16ths to 1 inch and a half. After that I set the manhole at the correct height by using a straight edge, and I try to find the perfect level between the stair and the tile sidewalk, making sure there is no gap between the straight edge and the manhole. In this case I use concrete beneath the manhole to make it level, but ideally it would be a plastic ring that goes underneath the manhole and lifts it depending of how much you need it to. It is especially useful if there is a lot of heavy cars driving over the manhole, but in our case the client did not wanted to invest more money into the project and he decided it is not worth it the investment since there will not be big cars driving over there. Finally, when the manhole is all leveled up, we focus on setting a metal bar on the end edge. Ideally, there would be a concrete curb, but then again the client opted for the faster solution of a straight edge iron bar of 1 cm thick and 5 cm tall that translates to roughly half an inch thick steel bar and 1.5 inch tall. After 2 days, when the concrete is completely dry, it is time to prime the concrete. But before we do that all the dust and sand or whatever foreign material from the top of the concrete needs to be removed. You can use a broom as we did, or a leaf blower, if you maybe work in an area where dust control is not as crucial as in our case here. Then, you will need a brush to spread the primer. In my case, I am using an old brush that I need to throw away anyhow. So this will be its last project. Make sure you are not using an expensive brush, because, the primer is not washable you will end up throwing away the tool in the end. When priming, you need to take particular care on the side edges, because, the better the asphalt sticks to the edges, the more chances it will last longer. If the edges are not primed, the asphalt will not stick, and the water will sweep in, causing premature damage, especially in a climate that has frost. Now, we get to the most crucial step, in order to get the best results. The planning. It is vital, that you have all the tools ready, and you are accustomed in using them. There's nothing worse than having the asphalt ready and you have difficulties in figuring out how the roller vibrator works, for example, or your plate vibrator is all dirty underneath, it will stain all your asphalt when stamping on the top of it. Then again, you cannot just drive to the asphalt plant and have the asphalt dumped into your trailer. No, you need to order it with at least a week in advance. So on the day of the pour, they have it ready for you, stored in the very warm asphalt silo, ready for you to pick it up. When ordering asphalt, you need to take into the consideration how many kilograms per square meter you need to order depending on the thickness of the asphalt, and also to include the 1 cm of compression that you will eventually lose by compaction. So keep that important aspect in mind when ordering. How to choose an asphalt size and thickness. 4. The size of the aggregate used to create asphalt pavement ranges from 1 to 2 cm or 1/2 inch to 3/4 inch. Smaller aggregate is usually used for residential driveways because it gives a smoother appearance. If the aggregate is larger, however, the pavement is stronger. The best layer thickness is 5 to 7 cm or 2 to 3 inches when laying asphalt on other surfaces than concrete. If heavy trucks and RVs are driven over the asphalt, a combination of a bottom layer with larger aggregate and a top layer with small aggregate is required. The thickness is evaluated in every separate project depending of the weight driven over and the undersoil. It is calculated by an engineer. Next, we are going to talk about transporting the asphalt from the asphalt plant to the job site. I personally like to keep my trailer clean. That means I lay some veneer plates on the bottom and on the sides of the trailer that are sprayed with diesel before. The diesel makes everything unlikely to become sticky. Next thing regarding planning is having the trained people to help you. And there's no better thing to do, other than share this video with them, and tell them you found our advice is useful. That would be a good deal for everyone. Also, if you find this video useful, please like and comment, maybe subscribe. It sure boosts our confidence after using so much time in making this video, filming, editing plus voiceovers etc. Finally, after all is done, all the planning and ordering and tool preparation, the big day has arrived. After the asphalt is on the job site, I like to start by warming up a little the primer with the gas torch. That makes a very good adhesion between the substrate, in our case the concrete, and the top layer asphalt. Then, we proceed in shoveling the asphalt in place, followed by the most crucial man on the job, the guy in charge with leveling the asphalt. The asphalt needs to have the right incline, the water needs to get away from the house, and it is not supposed to get puddles on top of the asphalt. All these things are responsibilities of the guy in charge of the leveling. On top of that, the person in charge of leveling needs to remember about compression, so, this layer needs the extra 1 cm for compaction. Very important aspect. After that is done, the roller is put to work. First, it is rolled without any vibration, starting with a half of the roll on the existing surface and half on the new. Then gradually, little by little, advancing more and more on the new surface. After 3 passes, you can start with vibration and with water. The more water, the better. Even tough at the beginning, you might think that is so counterintuitive. Trust me, it is a big help. Then, after you rolled the asphalt, you take the vibrating plate and stamp the sides, next to the house where the roller was not able to reach, and where the vibrating plate is unable to reach, you use the hand stamper. The end result should look smooth and with no signs of any uneven asphalt. After the laying is finished, you need to spread white sand on top. It will prevent the newly asphalt sticking to people's shoes or tires of cars that will soon drive over, and in the same time will get in small holes sealing them. As for an extra step, you might want to seal the joints with a sealer, best done while it is still warm. Now, before going to the bonus part, please remember to give us a like and a comment if you appreciate all the hard work we did in making this video. Thank you so much for doing so. It tells us we did a good job and we should continue in making videos. As promised, here is the bonus part: what mistakes to avoid in the cleaning the tools and long time storage. We start with cleaning the tools. When cleaning the tools, you need to use the gas torch and heat the tool, then the sticky asphalt will fall down. For long time storage again, you should set the tools in diesel. When they get cold, that is a very important aspect, you don't want a fire on your hands. The next thing on the bonus part is, what mistakes to avoid. As Werner Heisenberg once said, an expert is someone who knows some of the worst mistakes that can be made in his subject, and how to avoid them. Here we retrying to avoid the most common mistakes, that shortens the life of the asphalt. The most common mistake is water puddles on the newly laid asphalt. That is a problem that needs to be addressed quickly, since water and asphalt do not get along well. The fault lays on the guy doing the leveling. The next fail is also a visible one. After the roller went over the asphalt, there was extra asphalt laid on top, but since the older asphalt already got colder, there is a strip of ugly looking asphalt that did not get vibrated properly. The fault lays on the guy doing the leveling, not enough material, forgot about compaction. Another fail, that is visible only after big trucks or machines drive over, as crocodile skin. That is when the underlay is not properly prepared, and the surface sinks little by little, creating stripes that look like a crocodile skin and lead to potholes and total destruction of the area if not repaired. The reason for it, improper soil drainage and or underlay. Another failure to avoid, damaging tiles around the pour with the primer. This is a shocking failure, but definitely worth mentioning since it cost money to repair, and it is unwashable. Then for the last fail we will mention, that you can avoid, as the proper weed controls. You can see in this case the weed control was not done properly, and a lot of horsetail is growing trough the asphalt.